Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Peter. Before we try to know you, we'll introduce ourselves. I'm A.K. Singh, ex-Indian Revenue Service officer. She is Madam Bilkis Khatri. So first we congratulate you on clearing the main examination and that you are going to the interview, and we wish that you get into one of the prestigious services, whatever you desire for. What is your preference?
So IAS, then IFS, and then ITS.
Okay. So let's hope and wish that you get into IAS. Okay. And just tell me one thing, you passed your college in 2017.
Yes, sir.
And thereafter, after passing the college, what did you do?
So when I passed out of my college, my father, he got posted to Mumbai.
Okay.
So in 2017 itself, we shifted here. And for about 7 to 8 months, we were living in the guest house here because we did not get an accommodation. So during that time, sir, I did not start my preparation right on. And so I waited till the time we got settled here, and then from May 2018 I started.
Okay.
So during this course I was into modeling, sir, actually. Something so, which I started.
This is your first attempt?
Yes, sir.
Let me tell you, I'm not much aware of the data these days, but when we got into, 70% of the students, I mean the candidates who would get into the civil services, were getting in the first attempt. So the persons who are in the first attempt, their chances of getting into the services was 70% those days. I don't know, it might have varied now. But anyway, now madam?
Yeah, sure. So your father is from the armed forces?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So are you aware of AFSPA?
Yes, ma'am. Armed Forces Special Powers Act.
What are your views on it?
Ma'am, I believe that the kind of war that we are fighting, both externally as well as internally, we need such kind of laws to ensure that the army is able to run its operations smoothly, especially in these disturbed areas, be it J&K or the Northeast sector. Okay. So provided that the army follows a policy of giving respect to human rights, as well as to maintain peace and stability in the area, I think we need to have such balanced legislations now.
But you know about the recent Supreme Court ruling on AFSPA, like few years back? The latest ruling on AFSPA, where the Supreme Court said that even armed forces can be questioned if undue, unreasonable force is used. Because AFSPA gives a blanket protection.
So, yes, ma'am.
So, do you agree with this blanket protection, or if there is any human rights violation by the armed forces, they should be booked as such?
Ma'am, in line with the Supreme Court judgment, I believe that while there should not be any blanket immunity for anyone to carry out any violation of human rights, at the same time, from the forces point of view also, we have to ensure that we should more or less utilize the internal machinery within the army. Army already has a very strict machinery to carry out any sort of counter operations for human rights violation. There is speedy justice within the courts, armed forces, courts, tribunals. And I think that machinery is much more efficient, especially for the armed force cases. Because
how many such cases have you heard of where there has been some conviction or some action taken for human rights violation? Rather than army, in any institute or any authority, do you ever see themselves, they're filing cases against their own people and prosecuting them?
Ma'am, the army follows a very strict procedure in case of any such violations. The tribunals, they give justice within 1 year. So, and as far as the record of Indian army is concerned, ma'am, the conviction rate is less than 1 or 2%, because according to the statistics, ma'am, most of the cases are false cases which are filed to mislead the people.
So it's not the conviction rate with the tribunals is very less.
Ma'am, conviction rate is less because at times such cases are misused by our adversaries, ma'am. What essentially they do is to utilize this machinery to divert the attention of the army, and so that the army is not able to carry out its operations in the right way. So what I'm trying to say is,
there have been many protests going on in northeastern states against AFSPA. We have a case of your own, Sharmila.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, essentially we have to understand that the troops come from the same society that we live in. They're not some different people. But at the same time, ma'am, the army has an in-house procedure to carry out this entire human rights violation cases, ma'am. And therefore, we should respect their point of view as well. That's what my stand is, ma'am. And no human rights violation should be tolerated as a policy.
So that's what it is, then that's what, if the Supreme Court is looking into the matter, you say no, Supreme Court should not look at the tribunals within the armed forces should look into it for human rights violation cases.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, because at times of the...
Okay, we got your stand.
Okay.
About Haryana, your mother's from Haryana.
Yes, ma'am.
So Haryana has a very low sex ratio. So what steps can be taken to counter that?
Ma'am, a low sex ratio is a result of a large number of factors. So to tackle this, we need an all-round approach. Right from, firstly we have to start educating the people by incorporating the local panchayat leaders, the other local bodies. Because the grassroots democracy is from where the information dissemination is the fastest. So if we utilize those people and the religious leaders, if they can spread the message that, you know, a girl child is no less than a male child.
Then again, they are from the society. Why would they be different from the society who thinks the way they do?
Ma'am, I think the more devolved this entire process is, the more educated people become. Even the panchayat leaders, if
you
we
see
have
any
regular
changes now, are you in touch with Haryana? Do you see any
yes,
changes
ma'am.
Happening?
In my own district, ma'am, in Sirsa, the villages, they have started the policy that whenever a girl child is born, a tree is planted. So like these kind of positive messages, ma'am, they spread a good information in the society and they will bring a change. But it is a very slow process and the strict implementation of law is also required. So it's a carrot and stick that we have to balance out.
You have heard about Nirbhaya case presently, the death sentence has been announced.
Yes, ma'am.
But there is delay in handling. And the Home Ministry has approached the Supreme Court on expediting the process. What do you think about that?
Ma'am, I believe that rape in India is not only a brutal crime but also an emotional issue. Because we have to see from the victim's family point of view as well as the accused, ma'am. In this case, ma'am, there have been delays and purposeful delays because the review petitions have been filed in such a way so that the actual hanging is delayed further. But ma'am, at the same time, we have to realize that we cannot create a strict blanket law to cover all such cases. It largely matters on case-to-case basis.
So what is your point? Should we wait for the entire legal process to be exhausted before hanging them, or should the process be expedited and, you know?
Ma'am, the process has to be expedited, but at the same time, we have to realize that in this entire thinking of fastening the process, the justice should not be denied to the accused as well. So we have to make sure that the accused gets the right amount of choices to make the review petition. But at the same time frame could be reduced. For example, ma'am, in this case, instead of each person filing separate review petition, there can be a 1 week window wherein all the accused can file the petition.
And about the Hyderabad rape case in which there was a police encounter. What
yes, ma'am.
Think about that?
Ma'am, I believe
was that justice delivered? What do you think? How was it? Eventually, whether it was acted out or whether it was really the way it happened, was it justice delivered? What do you think?
Ma'am, I believe that without the actual inquiry report, I cannot say anything at this point of time, because the police statement is that they took out the encounter because the convicts, they were trying to escape the accused. Whereas the people say that, the opposites, they say that it was purposefully done so that, you know, justice is done immediately.
But eventually, do you think justice was delivered or what is your stand on that? Or you don't agree with this step?
Ma'am, I believe that the law should take its course. The law should be fastened, should be speedy. But at the same time, people cannot take law in their own hands. But in this case, ma'am, till the time the inquiry report comes, we cannot say anything, because it's not about emotional feelings that the people have. We also have to see the police point of view.
That's
why
what
they
said.
Those
that
people.
Was your statement that rape in India is also an emotional
Yes, ma'am. At times there's public pressure.
You don't think emotional issue, if it's emotions should take over legal process?
Absolutely not, ma'am. Emotions cannot be allowed to take over any person who is officially in charge of a duty. And in this case, ma'am, we also have to hear the police point of view, why they took those people early in the morning.
Right.
And the inquiry report only can tell that.
So, since you come from an army background, where all have you traveled to? Have you been staying with your father all along, or have you been staying put at one place and not traveling?
Ma'am, actually, I have changed around 11 schools in my life.
Mm-hmm.
So, we have been shifting to various places.
Okay.
But since my father is in the Dogra regiment,
okay.
So we have been posted mostly in the northern areas,
mm-hmm.
and also Tibri in Punjab,
mm-hmm.
and then Delhi, where I did my 11th and 12th in college, and then Mumbai.
Okay.
So
we have been shifting. Which all places other than Delhi and Bombay, where have you stayed?
Ma'am, as I said, Tibri, it's very near to Gurdaspur.
Mm-hmm.
And apart from that, mostly the areas of J&K,
Punj,
Bedibadi, Satwari, like there are different areas within the Jammu region, Nagroda.
So you have been to J&K quite a lot?
Yes, ma'am.
What do you think about the present situation there? You think it is justified that we are putting such a ban on the internet there? Is it justified there? You've seen the situation, I'm assuming.
Yes,
you've seen the situation personally, assuming your father comes from the Dogra regiment, which is an infantry regiment.
Yes, ma'am.
So you've seen it first hand, you've experienced it first hand. So what do you think? Is it justified, the ban on the internet there?
As the Supreme Court judgment said, that internet is a fundamental right. But at the same time, ma'am, we have to ensure that the safety and integrity of the nation cannot be put at stake. And therefore, if the requirement is, we have to put such bans on internet services and other communication services, but we have to ensure that the time frame is reduced. Only a minimal amount of such restrictions should be put, and they should be removed as easily as possible, as early as possible.
So India has had more bans than even Saudi Arabia. So
yes,
do you feel that now it is high time that we should let go of it, maybe in J&K at least? And shouldn't we get the people's opinion as well? Are they satisfied? The main aim of putting it is that there is no, with respect to, your 370,
yes.
Article 370, repealing of 370, there should not be anything which, provocates people more. Maybe, it could be something from cross-border. But don't you think that we are not just stopping that, but we are also not listening to the people's opinion?
Ma'am, people's opinion is paramount in any democracy, but for a temporary period of time, to maintain the law and order, stability, any sovereign state should have the right to put certain restrictions, ma'am. Especially in a case when we have so much of cross-border terrorism, proxy war that we're fighting with Pakistan. In such cases, to make sure that the operations of our military and the police there are carried out smoothly, people are doing stone pelting, they are essentially motivated by outside factors. And as the recent army chief statement came out, there fundamentalism which is growing in J&K. So to carry out the operations smoothly, we need certain restrictions. But as I said, ma'am, they should be removed as early as possible. And I think the government is taking the efforts in that direction.
So since you mentioned stone pelting, you might be aware of that issue where one of the majors, I don't remember his name, he tied a person to the jeep. So do you think that was justified? In that case, you just mentioned the army has washed off its hands. They say nothing like that happened, or they have not punished him.
Yes, ma'am.
Whereas the pictures were there, everything was there.
Ma'am, in fact,
there was
a matter of fact, he was awarded.
He was awarded, exactly. So where is the conviction there? In case of, the tribunals that you say that they are very just, they're looking into those matters. So where is the human rights versus the rights of the troops there? What is your point on that? That should we actually be dealing their stone pelting and violence with pellet guns and such measures?
Ma'am, the situation on ground is very different from what we feel from here. Talking about the case of Major Gogoi, ma'am, the situation that he faced was that he was trapped. There were people around him who were trying to kill him as well as his men. Had he not done that, more people would have been killed, more force would have been required to carry out the law and order operations, and it would have created a mess there.
I don't understand. He was being killed, he was being gagged, ghera out, you are saying.
Yes, ma'am.
So then when you are ghera out, when any person is ghera out, he pulls up a person and ties to the jeep. That's what you do when you are threatened by being killed.
Ma'am, army does not follow a policy of making human shields.
So that's what you are saying. You are justifying his act, right? By saying that he was threatened to be killed. So are you justifying his act by saying that he was threatened to be killed is my question.
Ma'am, what I'm trying to justify is that if somebody is threatening your life, then as a self-defense measure, I think our law permits that.
Our law permits that you entire person to a jeep.
Ma'am, I think that only the person who is on the field has the right to decide that, ma'am. Because
so you mean that armed forces have a right to decide what they do on the field and nobody can question them for that? Because they have a right to decide they are in the situation. That's what you're saying.
Ma'am, if your life is at stake and your men whom you are controlling, their life is at stake, I think to get out of that situation, at times, you have to take such measures.
Like, what you are saying is like tying a person.
Ma'am, he tied that person, he got out of that area, and then they untied him. There was no harm done to him, ma'am. So essentially, I feel that in case of self-defense cases, ma'am, we have to take certain measures. And only the person on ground can decide.
So means you mean that if there is a case of a person entering in, barging in, and when they try to escape and they put a gun on some civilian's head, that is fine. They are trying to save their lives. So that is allowed.
Ma'am,
putting a person in danger is allowed because you are trying to save yourself.
Ma'am, there is a difference when an Islamic State person, he pulls out some innocent woman in front of him to act as a human shield.
How did Islamic State come into this? Talk, I didn't understand.
Ma'am, essentially, like if the terrorists, if they are.
You can't compare the terrorists with the armed forces, sir.
Yes.
So don't give that comparison.
Ma'am, what I'm trying to say is that the intention matters more at times than the act. The intention of the army officer was not to kill that person or to harm that person, but just to get out of the situation.
So we are allowed to do anything to get out of the situation. Or only the armed forces are allowed to do anything to get out of the situation.
Ma'am, I feel that if we are expecting them to save the country, to lay their lives, at times we have to allow them to take out certain harmless measures which may appear to violate certain rights at that point of time.
So you are aware that other than just keeping our borders safe or keeping the country safe, we use the army for other purposes, isn't it? Disaster relief, right now we have, not just in India, we use it for disaster relief in other nations as well.
Yes.
Right. So you're aware of Operation Vanilla?
Ma'am, it was carried out by the Indian Navy in Madagascar for the cyclone Diane that Madagascar is facing right now. About 90,000 people are affected by it. So that's why as a goodwill measure our country is doing that.
So do you think it is justified when we have an NDRF, we have so many acts of disaster. Do you think that army should also be carrying out this, pulling people out of wells, going and helping during earthquakes? Is it justified putting the army there at that time? When we have in place things like that, the NDRF.
Ma'am, essentially I feel that each agency has a required mandate and they should carry that out. But ma'am, during peacetime, when the army is not very occupied on the borders, as a last resort, we can utilize them if the country is in crisis. Because essentially, ma'am, the first mandate of any security force is to maintain the situation within the country. And if the external threat is not that immediate, then army can be utilized. But we should try to limit it.
So you've been to Femina Miss India 2016, you've been a finalist.
Yes.
So do you feel that such parents, this is one of the things that goes against such parents, that they mostly suggest objectification of women. So what is your take on that? Is it objectification of women? Is it growth of personality? Should it be allowed? And sometimes, 16-17 year old people are there, right? 18 year olds are there. Now they have child pensions also, right? So do you think, is it putting too much unnecessary pressure on the children? Or on these young women? Or men also? Yes, you have these things for men also.
Yes, during the era. Ma'am, I feel that when the idea of these pageants started, they were essentially just swimsuit concerts. But now, ma'am, over a period of time, it has now become a platform where girls young of my age, they get an opportunity to put across their talent, to raise their voice on the issues that they face, to forge ahead in whatever areas that they wish. It's not that if you enter into this pageant, you're only going to get to become beauty queen and you cannot do anything else. I participated, I gained so much of self-confidence through this pageant, ma'am. And I think in some way or the other, it has helped me to sit here today. Because of the kind of exposure that you get, there are people coming across from the industry who are trying to groom you, who are trying to teach you. So I think it's no more an objectification pageant. There is so much of charity work that Miss World Organization does. About $2 billion per year are donated for Children Fund. So I think it has become an evolved platform wherein so much more can happen.
And what was the issue that was close to you that you wanted to go and serve for had you would have made the full way through this? Maybe you would have won. What was the issue that you would have supported?
Ma'am, my Beauty with a Purpose project for this particular pageant was about children education, ma'am. So running parallel schools in the evening wherein young college students, they can come and they can volunteer to teach the children. So that was my cause that I supported in this pageant.
What is your take on this post of the CDS?
Ma'am, the CDS was recommended by all three committees that were constituted for the Armed Forces Reform, right from Kargil Committee to Naresh Chandra Committee and recently Shekhar Committee. It was a very necessary measure, ma'am, because there has to be a single point advisory to our political executive regarding the interoperability and the efficiency of our armed forces to give a strategic direction overall. Because right now, ma'am, we have about 17 different commands of the various forces, Army, Navy, Air Force. We have three chiefs and there is no interoperability as such. So I think to bring across a synergy amongst the armed forces, this was a required mission.
Why isn't there any interoperability? What is the reason behind?
Ma'am, essentially the reason flows because of the fact that all three services are acting in silos. There is compartmentalization, ma'am. If we take the case of Mumbai itself, ma'am, when the 2008 attack happened, the police did not have the number of the army did not have the number of Navy. So there's
but
no
in the CDS, the police is not involved, it's just the three Army, Navy.
Yes, ma'am. Police is not involved. But what I'm trying to say is that there is no interoperability when it comes to our security forces. And there is a need to bring that cohesion in their working. Because right now, the external and internal threats, there is a lot of, dilution in the strict walls that were separating them. Pakistanis are funding our insurgent groups. They have connections, safe havens abroad. So we need an entire integrated mechanism and a strategic policy towards our security.
Sir.
What was your optional subject in the UPSC?
Sir, economics.
Tell me, about demonetization, Dr. Manmohan Singh said that it has pushed back the Indian economy. It has reduced the growth rate. Whereas the proponents of or the supporters of demonetization say that it has achieved great purposes. Whom would you like to agree with? With Dr. Manmohan Singh or with the supporters of demonetization? And why?
Sir, I believe that both of them are correct in their own way. Demonetization did come as a short-run shock to the economy. But it will bring, as the economic survey also suggested, it will bring lots of long-term measures and long-term improvement in our economy. If you talk about the short-run shocks, there were lines in front of the ATM, the aggregate demand suffered, the supply side of the unorganized sector, the agriculture sector, mostly cash-based economy, that suffered. But if we talk about the long-term benefits, digitalization is one of them, increase in our tax base, and also formalization of our economy. So I think in the long run, the black money, the digitalization, they were given the push. So I think it was a beneficial move and the intention behind such a move was noble.
Yeah, but people are, I mean, the economy is still suffering from the pain of demonetization because the informal economy has not been able to really get up. And that's why you find our growth rate is quite substandard. Because, you know, one of the objectives of demonetization was that black money will be backed out.
Yes.
Now, about 15 lakh crore or whatever number was in circulation, currency notes were in circulation. Almost 99% got deposited back in the system.
Yes, sir.
Now, where is the black money then? Because everything went back to the system. And till date, there is no data. And you know, there are, you may be aware, there are various studies which have said that the component of black money, supposing black money is 100 rupees, out of that, only 6% is held in the form of cash. Out of 100 rupees of black money, only 6% is held in the form of cash. So by demonetization, we attack at best that 6%. And that 6% also got, back into the system in her name, in my name, in her name, in your name, his name, and all that. And even now, Income Tax Department has not been really been very successful in saying, hey, whatever has been deposited in her account or her account is black money. So it has. The economy has taken a beating. You are right that digitization of economy or formalization of economy is a good step, and to that extent this has done a service. But it has really impacted the rural economy, because the rural economy was all cash based. There was no black money in villages. Have you seen villages?
Yes, sir.
The villages, there is no black money. Villages may, there is only income. I mean, there is no black money because, you know, they are all agriculture based.
Yes.
So the black money, actually, you know, we all know, because, you know, I worked in Income Tax Department for 38 years. We know where the black money is, but we don't touch that question. Anyway, now coming back to this, you want to join bureaucracy. A great Indian said that, please listen to my statement carefully. It is difficult not to test the honey that finds itself on the tip of the tongue. It is difficult not to test the honey that finds itself on the tip of the tongue. Now, this was said about the bureaucracy. Can you tell me who said this?
Sir, I am not really aware of who said this.
Okay. Anyway, Kautilya said this in Arthashastra. Kautilya wrote in Arthashastra long back. Now, you think it is it is true today also, in terms when we try to measure bureaucracy in terms of corruption or probity or integrity? How do you view the bureaucracy, Indian bureaucracy today? Is it free from corruption? Are they not testing the honey that finds itself on their tongue?
Sir,
what is your view on this?
Sir, I feel that what Chanakya said years ago, to a certain extent, it is very true even today. Corruption is inevitable in our system. There is a lot of corruption right from bottom to the top. But I feel, sir, that today, with the maturization of our democracy, there is also a certain system of accountability and transparency which is got into. As the Indian democracy has progressed, sir, public accountability and fairness, the Right to Information Act, the recent voluntary retirement to a large number of tax department officials, all these measures, sir, and more importantly, the use of technology that we have seen in the recent years, they are trying to reduce this corruption. And also, sir, I feel that not everyone in the bureaucracy is corrupt, but at times the work conditions are such that people are forced into it, or the work culture develops in a way that the discipline goes away. So I think the more we sensitize our bureaucracy right from the beginning, if we train them in the right values, ethical values, then I think change can be brought in.
Yes. Apart from attitudinal change that you are talking about, what we can do is we can reduce the human interface.
Yes.
We can bring, we can make better use of computers.
Yes.
Don't meet a person with whom you have work. Like supposing somebody wants some grant from you. You are a district collector somewhere, somebody wants a grant for her, for the school or whatever. You don't meet. Just see the application on the internet.
Yes.
And have the criteria prescribed. Whether that criteria meets, if it meets, the grant goes. And you know, the corruption happens why? When two persons meet. When you are only looking at the computer, there can be no corruption.
Yes, sir.
So increased use of computers in government systems and reducing human interface is will be one of the big steps or important steps in removing corruption, and maybe thereafter the bureaucrats will not.
The tax department is also working in this direction, like with the faceless assessment, faceless appeal.
You have heard of this faceless assessments and faceless appeals?
Yes, in the last budget, our finance minister talked about this, and it has been implemented. The faceless assessment parts. You reduce the human interface when it comes to assessing the income tax return and file.
Good. Now tell me, what is this? Why is a government banks they have so much of NPA?
Sir, because.
And why not private banks?
So there are multiple reasons for it, sir. Political influence on our public sector banks. There is no regulatory neutrality, sir. RBI has limited powers over the public sector banks as compared to the private sector banks. Also, sir, the management issues, the PNB fraud case, it brings out a lot of managerial inefficiencies in our public sector banks. And lastly, sir, the NPAs have been increasing because in the boom period of our Indian economy, sir, right from 2003 to 2008, the corporate sector, there was a credit boom in it. And when the bubble burst in 2008 financial crisis, post that the NPAs have increased tremendously. Essentially, what the twin balance sheet problem that ex-chief economic advisor Mr. Arvind Subramanian also talked about. So due to these problems, sir, the NPA problem is existing.
So you mean the government interference, lack of professionalism?
Yes, sir.
So what do we do to improve the banking system? I mean the government banking system. What should be done?
Sir, I believe that firstly, the RBI should have neutral regulatory powers over the private as well as public sector banks. We need to treat them on par at the same level so that efficient monitoring can be done. In these cases, sir, prevention is better than cure. The more credit history and KYC norms that the public sector banks follow, the more careful analysis they do, the better would be the loan repayment mechanism. Also, sir, the central repository of credit that the RBI is going to implement very soon, I think that will give a big boost to reducing these NPA problems. Because if you have the credit history of the person from whichever bank that person has taken loan, whether they have repaid, how is their income flow and how is their repayment mechanism, I think all these things can help. Also, sir, the public sector banks, they have to maintain the adequate capital ratio so that there is no problem of getting into the prompt corrective action framework of RBI. So capital adequacy, effective monitoring, regulatory neutrality of the RBI, and also infusing competition into the banking sector, sir. We can think of FDI into the banking sector, private sector and as well as public sector banks listing their shares on our stock exchanges. All this is going to bring efficiency in our banking sector.
Yesterday I was seeing on the TV, there is a, you must have heard of this place called Shaheen Bagh in Delhi.
Yes, sir.
In Shaheen Bagh, about a week back or so, 4 or 5 days back, there was some firing. A fellow was caught, Delhi police caught that fellow. And they are supposed to make investigations and all that. And, prosecute the person as well. The case was assigned to Crime Branch of Delhi. Yesterday evening I saw a fellow DCP Crime Branch. He was holding a press conference. He said that the fellow who has opened fire in Shaheen Bagh belongs to Aam Aadmi Party, AAP, that is Kejriwal's party. How do you see this press conference of a police fellow? Is he being professional? Is it his job to identify his political leanings? Or he is supposed to investigate the crime, whether he fired or he did not fire, and why he fired, and what punishment should be meted out to him? Or should he investigate whether he belongs to BJP, or he belongs to Congress, or he belongs to Aam Aadmi Party? What is your view on his professionalism, or professionalism of the police?
Sir, I believe that as a police official, your first value or the first thing that you should have is political neutrality and impartiality. You cannot let any political influence come in the way of your duty. In this case of press conference, sir, I believe that when talking about this crime, the more focus should be on why that crime occurred, why that person fired, and who that person is, and not talking about the political leanings of that person. Because when the political element comes in, the actual crime committed, that sort of fades away. So the essential key issue in this matter is that the person was taking law in his own hands. He fired at a protest, a peaceful protest that was going on, and it was unlawful. So I think the police has to take action on that person according to the crime committed, irrespective of which political party he belongs to.
Have a glass of water. I'll also have thereafter. I'll ask you one or two more questions.
Okay, sir.
What do we do to improve the functioning of the police? How can we improve it?
So firstly, we need to bring modernization in our police forces, be it equipment wise, be it strategy wise. In every sense, our police still functions in the colonial era of Police Act 1861. We need to infuse modern technology and efficient policing, sir. Secondly, sir, the relationship between the police and the people is only one-sided, that is of fear. We see a policeman and we fear him. I think this relationship has to change. Community policing, having great rapport with the local people, so that the police and the people are both aware of each other's function and there can be accountability in that sense. Thirdly, sir, we need to segregate the criminal investigation as well as the normal local policing, sir. Because essentially when there is a mix-up of functions, none of them perform their duty efficiently in many cases. So I think proper segregation, accountability mechanism, and also, sir, modernization. These are the three top priorities which I feel that we should work upon.
See, India's relations with its neighbors, we have very cordial relation with Nepal. But I find that Nepal is tilting towards China. Why are we not able to conduct our foreign policy in such a fashion that we have this small, our immediate neighbors like Bangladesh and Bhutan, and of course Bhutan is friendly, Bangladesh, Nepal, etc. on our side? Why is it that they are tilting towards China? What is, I mean, how would you like to improve the our Indian foreign policy?
Sir, right from the Gujarat Doctrine, which talked about how India as a major dominant power in the South Asia should carry out unilateral development projects and other projects in our neighbouring countries, unilateral concessions to them, to the recent policy of neighbourhood first, sir. We have always placed our neighbours as a priority when it comes to our external affairs policy. But sir, the recent shifting, especially Nepal towards China, is essentially resource driven. China is undertaking a debt trap diplomacy. They are infusing lots of money, lots of debt into the smaller countries, be it Nepal, be it Sri Lanka. The One Belt, One Road project of China, sir. It's again, it's an string of all. These are all policies to encircle India. And we, sir, we are still a 3 trillion economy. China is a 14 trillion economy. They have much more resources than we do. But at the same time, I feel that through our soft power, through our ancient historical relations, and also the fact that India is a democracy, these are three very important features of our strength, sir, and we should leverage them to create a more friendly atmosphere between our neighboring nations.
But see, here resource crunch, you said that China is using its resources.
Yes.
You know, India sometime back gave about $1 billion to Russia for some development in the Far East.
Yes, sir.
When our Prime Minister had gone there, he was shown with a press conference with Putin, and India gave an assistance of $1 billion to Russia to improve the conditions in the Far East of Russia.
Yes, sir.
Now, if we have the resources to help Russia, which itself is a superpower, why can't we invest the resources in Nepal?
Sir, talking about that particular agreement, sir, essentially, the reason why we are so interested in Russian Far East is not only because as a diplomatic relation with Russia, but also because the Far East is very rich in gas resources. And China is already leveraging that. They have pipelines from the Russian Far East to the China. So I think the reason why we are investing is for our own strategic perspective and energy security. And the more we develop that region, the more infrastructure that we build, we would be able to import gas from there at a much cheaper rate. I think that is the policy that Indian government is trying to make, sir. And also, since Russia is also part of the BRICS initiative, the more friendliness that we have between the BRICS countries, it will bring more cohesion in our economic policies and trade, sir. That is the reason why we are investing in Russia. When it comes to Nepal, sir, Nepal is again India's priority. It's not that we are taking away Nepal's share or our neighborhood first policy share to these countries. But that is a different strategic vision, and this is a different strategic vision. Sir. That's
right. You have been engaged in debates in the college?
Yes, sir. I was a part of debating society.
I just asked you to read one thing in the today's newspaper. Give me some arguments for and against this. Just read this. Take up to 3 minutes time. How much time you will take to read this?
About
3 minutes. Centrists stand in the Supreme Court. Think it over and then tell me some points in favor and against both. Or if you are comfortable speaking only on one side, then please speak only on one side. The choice is left to you. You think it over, formulate your views, and tell me either whether you will argue for both the sides or you will argue only for one side.
So could I use a pen or paper?
Yes.
firstly, I would like to talk about why the army is against induction of women, especially in combat. Firstly, sir, our troops, they come from the same society where we live in. And since there's so much of patriarchy in our society, the troops aren't ready. They come from villages where women aren't even allowed to come out of the four walls of their houses. And here when they see women wearing that combat uniform, parading with them, carrying out operations with them, it will create a social problem within the units itself. So that is the first point why the army feels that women should not be inducted in combat at this point of time. Also, sir, logistically, the army has We have recently launched the National Infrastructure Pipeline, about 103 lakh crores in infrastructure alone. It is going to generate a lot of in both of them I have stayed very less.
One last question I have for you. What made you, you come from an army background, what made you pick up civil services over, maybe giving the CDS exam?
Ma'am, when I was in my 11th and 12th, my schooling was in Sanskriti, the civil services school, Delhi.
Okay.
And most of my friends' parents, they were into civil services. And when I used to see them, ma'am, the enormous power that this service has got, you can make so much difference in the lives of people. You can not only contribute to your nation's building, but also at the same time, it gives you that job satisfaction that yes, my voice has power and I can utilize it for the benefit of our nation.
Army doesn't have that?
Ma'am, Army does have that. And I think, ma'am, Army or civil services, they're both two sides of the same coin. Like, a soldier dies for the nation, a civil servant lives for the nation. So I was more interested in this particular field, ma'am. That's why I chose it.
So you've never studied in Army schools?
Ma'am, throughout my life, I've studied in many Army schools. Only my last part of 11th and 12th, they were done in Sanskriti. Other than that, I was mostly in Army.
So, the Army schools were not able to move you as much as the Sanskriti school could?
Ma'am, at that point of time, I did not decide my career option. But when I came in my 11th and 12th, that is when I gave it a serious thought. And I thought, this is the right service in which I would want to get into.
Okay.